and take control of the map and try to siege if they can. And look, we'll see how it works out, because of course Beast on the Nidalee, not necessarily what I want to see out of Snake, but maybe they'll pick it again. Maybe they'll try and make it work this time around. But we are into Champion Select, ladies and gentlemen. Sivir and LeBlanc going to be leaving the board as far as Snake are concerned. It is going to be Kalista and Rek'Sai off the table now for EDG. We'll see what the final bans are going to be. The jungle only going to be touched as far as Rek'Sai is concerned. So Gragas still available. A big pick here, especially for late game and all the disengage that he does provide.
Yeah, the Sivir being banned is a smart reactive ban to what happened in the first game. Even the Azir being banned, both the two factors that really stumped them, that stopped them in their tracks when they were trying to utilize what their team was meant to do as a five. They hit that objective control, and the Azir and the Sivir both just said no. The Sivir ultimate was what caught Maokai out of position last game, what caught Flandre in a bad spot, and essentially won them the game by two inhibitors being down from that. So getting rid of it is a smart decision, and even the Nidalee in response here being banned away.
Oh, Flandre is going to lock away the Hecarim. The Gnar is available, though. Koro, of course, champion pool, not going to be dented at all, as Clearlove looking to try and pick up the cow now for Mako. Of course, Ella did manage to pick that one up last time around, but not going to be happening this time. And look, it's interesting because there are a whole lot of high-priority picks. Cassiopeia still on the table now as well.
Yeah.
And without the Azir there to pick into it, look, we'll see what it is going to be. Of course, is it more like if Cassiopeia is picked, you pick Azir, or is it if you pick Azir, you pick Cassiopeia? How does that work?
It seems to go either way. They just seem to be the matchup that ideally wants to go against each other. And even when one's banned, they like to ban the other. It's just a little bit mind-blowing with why they do that.
Look, I'm baffled. I just like to get excited and yell about things, so thankfully, I don't necessarily need to know. So let's just let it happen, see how it works out in the future. But Yu is just going to waste no time locking the Snake Lady. This is already a very high-powered lineup from Snake. Lots of late-game potential and massive damage, as this Gragas, if it is going to be locked in, then that's almost top priority for everyone. But Koro's back on his Gnar, the Alistar in the hands of Mako as well. Pawn, thinking about it, Jace.
Why not?
Yeah. Standard. Oh, Deft. He has the option of picking his Jinx as well. Or, you know, Deft's Corki. You can see he's got a little bit of a smirk on his face.
Urgot's still available as well while we're touching on AD carries. So Jinx is seemingly priority number one in terms of AD carries at the moment.
Yeah.
Urgot probably number two behind Sivir, of course, because Sivir is banned. And Kalista even. So limitations of what you can pick as an AD carry right now seem to be almost exclusively the Urgot and the Jinx, as he just... What?
It still could be Clearlove. It still could be Clearlove playing the Pantheon, but that is what Pawn has decided, possibly, to take into the Cassiopeia in the mid lane. Of course, Pantheon is a disgusting laner.
Yes.
Especially in the mid lane, throwing out relentless spears. Of course, you're not going to have a whole lot of mobility, so you just do your buttons on the Cassiopeia. She prob's going to die. That's like how it works. Of course, you do have to be facing her.
Let's save ourselves the brain power here. Let's not dwell on what could be a Pantheon mid before we see the finished draft of
EDG. No, I highly doubt that.
I know that you want to talk about it so much.
Okay, well, Martin,
we have to wait.
Martin is going to be taking what looks like the Corki into the Urgot. We'll see whether Ella can manage to perform on this Morgana the way that Mako did. And look, I think you might be correct.
They just, no hesitation, do they? They look like they're trolling.
Look
Let's
at him.
Not. Again, we're going to wait till they lock in. EDG are just messing with us right now.
They are. They are. I like it, though. I like it. As,
exciting.
You know, yeah, talking
Unexpected.
About things that may not actually happen here as Mako hovering the Varus continues. Let's see whether they switch it up. Of course, the laughter has abated. Oh, my goodness, if they do it.
let's look at the Finnish team comp here from Snake. We'll let them do their thing, okay? The Finnish comp from Snake is very strong, but it has almost got a time limit on it for the AD carry and the support duo. They've got the Cassiopeia and the Hecarim. Both do a lot of work. Okay. Is that?
No.
Okay, good.
It's going to be swapped. Yep, there
they scale really well here on the side of Snake. They've got the Hecarim top, the Cassiopeia, but then the Corki will start to become a little bit of a non-factor the later the game goes. So they need to find their item spikes and their item timings when they want to fight.
Well, it's also true for Deft as well. I mean, Urgot probably going to fall off a little bit in the later stages as well.
Yeah. It does drop off a bit, but then he's also got this weird team comp that's aggressive and in their face that might still complement the Urgot's play style pretty perfectly.
Yeah, you do have the swap, the switcheroo. Mm. Of course, not Jinx's passive on her Q, but it is going to be working out relatively similarly. But it is going to be the Gnar into the Hecarim. We've seen this one work very well for Gnars in the past. Beast is going to be taking the Gragas against the very standard Pantheon jungle, as you on the Cassiopeia against Pawn's fabled Fizz. I mean, this guy is a massive Fizz player, as Corki into Urgot is going to be happening, as El is going to try and do his best Mako impression, trying to land all the bindings. In fact, the support's just going to switch.
Yeah, we'll see how many bindings he can land, because based off the last game, the impact a Morgana can have when those binds hit is through the roof.
Yes, most definitely. And El has got a lot on his back if he's going to have a performance like that one yet again. And I just want to apologize, because I actually got Clear Love and Koro mixed up before. Of course, Koro took some time out, and I just, for some reason, forgot what his face looked like, ladies and gentlemen. But of course, that was him on your screen before. And then we had a look over at Flandre instead. So, look, just wanted to clear that one up. Just apologize to Koro, because, look, he's a glorious human being.
He is a glorious human being, and he's going to be on a glorious champion right now up against the Hecarim.
Yeah.
As you said, it goes quite well in the favor of Gnar, and it depends on how the lane goes as to what the Gnar generally builds as well. We've seen a lot of Black Cleaver since the later patches, and we'll see what he actually wants to do. If he wants to go straight tanker, if he wants to sit on the Phage for a while, or if he wants to go for the Black Cleaver and just man up a little bit. And we know this is EDG, so they probably do.
Yeah, that's just generally how it works out. Of course, we are going to have sort of Flandre wanting to make it towards that later stage of the game. You know, build a Cinderhulk, build a Trinity Force maybe, or he might just go full tank. Often we see the three tanky items, Cinderhulk into the Spirit Visage and the Frozen Heart, and then you grab the Trinity Force and have sort of a later spike, make sure that you're tanky, able to soak a whole heap of damage in these mid-game fights. But look, we'll see what Flandre does. He mixes things up more often than he doesn't, honestly, on Summoner's Rift. So look, we'll see what it is going to be from him this time around. But against the Gnar, I mean, you can build Frozen Mallet and the Black Cleaver and just have all of the control of the lane that you'd ever want and shut out this Hecarim, force him to be a jungler.
That also says to me that you're looking to split push from start to finish. And if we have a look at the side that they've got here,
that's true.
You may not be opting into split pushing the entire time. You may be looking to team fight. As we're talking about the top lane, the Hecarim's itemization and his choices on what he wants to go are generally relative on what the rest of your team has. So if you've got a big front line, and if your lane is okay, you're not getting stomped in lane, then you can afford to go for a Trinity Force earlier. Otherwise, you opt into the tankiness because your team needs to accelerate their gameplay, fight a little bit earlier. And of course, tanky stats are relative to when you want to fight the game. If you see someone rush a Randuin's Omen opposed to a damage spell, even on the Gnar, who might go for a Randuin's before the Phage, that says to me that they want to fight sooner rather than later.
Yeah, well, look, we'll see how it does work out. I want to touch on the mid lane here because, of course, you being previously a mid lane player, you probably know how this one is going to work. But Cassiopeia versus Fizz. Fizz, I feel, probably has a fair bit of outplay potential.
There's outplay potential, definitely outplay potential, but it's also a lane where he's a melee hero.
Against Cassiopeia.
Against the Cassiopeia, yeah.
Which is always going to be crap, right?
Level 2 Cass is very strong. Has the twin fangs with the poison that's going to always be a relevant threat. She's going to be able to most likely push the Fizz away from the minions just because the control that a ranged champion has is overwhelming against the melee champion. But Fizz does have the outplay potential. So every time that he goes for a last hit, he's going to have to be thinking reactively to what is going to happen in that mid lane. Do I need to use the troll pole right now to dodge a spell, or will this get me killed in the end? Everything is going to be a big mind game because not necessarily skill shots, but decision making is going to impact how that lane goes. Cassiopeia, a very squishy hero champion, going to take a lot of damage if the Fizz gets on top of her.
Yeah.
But it's going to be very hard to get on top of a Cassiopeia as Fizz.
Yeah, and can you actually Petrifying Gaze before the Urchin Strike comes through? So if you see Pawn actually press his Q, can you just ult him in the face and it stops it? Or is that an unstoppable move?
It should stun him. It comes down to timing as well, though.
Okay.
I believe it puts you behind them if it goes off right. So it's going to be hard to actually execute. If you do execute it right, you ult preemptively so that while he's traveling with the animation, you stun him. It should stun him. It'll do damage, I believe, but it'll still stun him.
Okay, well, we'll see how Pawn is able to navigate this lane because it might be involving a whole lot of roaming around the map. We saw that this was how Westor was able to create so much pressure on his Fizz when he was playing it at MSI. Of course, ladies and gentlemen, we do have a pause at the beginning of the game. That's why we're here chatting to you for a little bit longer than otherwise expected. So we will get into it as soon as we possibly can. But like I said, Westor, he managed to pick up a whole lot of his advantages around moving around the map faster, being able to clear out minion waves with a playful Trickster, and then just moving himself into positions he was looking for.
Yeah, and it's something that Fizz is very good at.
Yeah.
Disappearing from the mid lane or finding a chance to disappear where the Cassiopeia is not going to take your turret would be very nice to do prior.
Yeah.
It's not always easy to push the wave out, so sometimes you sacrifice a fair bit to do that. But if you can, if you can roam and have some relevance everywhere, use the fish, get it down onto some people and do some serious damage, you're going to be in a very good position, even if you've sacrificed the lane pressure. The thing is, the Cassiopeia is always going to have this lane pressure, so maybe you want to jungle gank first to push her back, get some control of mid, and then look to roam.
Well, we'll see whether he can actually do that, because of course Fizz has to use often his playful Trickster if he wants to push out a minion wave. So if you're going to be putting that on cooldown on purpose, could be a little bit difficult because you may just get killed, because that's a large amount of what you're going to be using to try and keep yourself safe.
Yeah, definitely. It's a real threat that the Cassiopeia can just turn it on out of nowhere and just start blowing you up, and it puts you in a bad position, might force a summoner spell. Again, it's a very volatile lane, and we've just explained in depth as to why it is so volatile. The damage that both of them deal are exceptional. They both scale very well in terms of damage, but it is going to come down to execution, decision-making, and jungle pressure. If there is the jungle pressure there from either side, EDG or Snake, it could go either way again. If there's a 2v2, it's very hard to pick who would come out ahead.
Well, we'll see whether there is going to be a 2v2, because I don't actually know how this bottom lane matchup generally works. Of course, Morgana Corki is something that we've seen a fair bit of. Of course, if someone gets hit by a Dark Binding, you're going to cop a heck of a lot of poke.
Yeah.
What with the Gatling Gun and, of course, the Phosphorus Bomb there as well, just being available for a Corki. But I want to talk about the fact that, you know, as Urgot, you generally want to be picking up a Frozen Heart. And Corki does a heck of a lot of mixed damage. So I sort of like the Corki pick in this regard. But is it not necessarily going to work just because Urgot is such a fantastic laner once he hits level 3?
Well, it won't be solely because the magic damage that the Corki deals is high as to why the lane goes really well for the Urgot. Most Urgots have been rushing the Black Cleaver first.
Yes, that's true.
So there's no armor relevance as to why the Corki pick is so superior to any other AD carry. The big thing to note here, though, is if we look at the bot lane, the Corki Morgana up against the Urgot Alistar, they're weak. At level 1, Urgot and Alistar, they don't do a whole lot.
Yep.
They can run out of mana if pressured by the Morgana and the Corki. So maybe they want to look to lane swap. Or maybe just to get some experience onto this Urgot to get him to level 3 before swapping back. But then you have to take into account that you've got the Naren to the Hecarim matchup that you want. So why would you do that? It's going to be a big risk. They have to make a sacrifice. Do they want to have a really rough lane in the bot lane? Or do they want to lane swap and make it easier for the Urgot? But then they're taking Gnar away from what is generally known as a favorable matchup. It's going to be a big decision for them to make coming into this game.
Yeah, it's like, do you sacrifice the fact that Koro might be able to get a massive advantage early on for a better time for Deft and Mako? And of course, Deft and Mako were largely what makes the difference in the later stages of the game. But look, we'll see what happens, because of course, Koro, we've seen him be a huge menace. And when you're on a playmaker like Gnar, maybe it's worth having this Gnar at a position to carry.
Yeah, it could be. Potentially the difference between winning or losing the game is if the Gnar gets a good lane against the Hecarim, it'll take longer for the Hecarim to scale. There's a lot of factors to take into account, and it is going to be a big decision if they look to lane swap. It might mix the game up, but we have seen Edward Gaming are so good with their rotational play.
Yeah.
They slowly but surely bled out Snake in that first game, and it was on the back of vision and roaming and just rotation and decision making that they actually executed perfectly. So coming into this game, will they be able to do the same thing if they put the Urgot in the 2v2, where the pressure will most likely be them on the back foot?
Yeah.
Or will they be able to utilize the 1v2 lane swap? Or will they just even win the 2v2? We never know what they're actually going to do.
Well, this is the thing. This is Mako and Deft. I mean, this is a duo that's been able to do pretty amazing things in the past. But, of course, Martin, relatively untested. We haven't seen too much from him. We'll see whether he's going to be able to bring something new for Snake here as well, now on a more of a mid-game damage-spiking AD carry, such as Corki. So a little bit of, like, potential double Trinity Force power spike is going to be hit here, but of course, when you are taking the Smite Teleport on a Hecarim, you probably want to be picking up the Cinderhulk and delaying that Trinity Force just a little bit. But ladies and gentlemen, pause is going to be over, so let's get onto the Rift. And here we are, ladies and gentlemen, onto the Rift for Game 2 between EDG and Snake. EDG managed to pick up Game 1 in rather convincing fashion towards the end there after Snake put on some early pressure, but overcame it relatively nicely. And, oh man, I love Toboggan Corki. So cool.
It's a really good skin, actually.
It's his most streamlined skin. I feel like he's cutting through the air
Jamaican
a little bit better.
Jamaican bobsled Corki.
Yeah. I mean, it doesn't make a whole lot of sense, the fact that you'd be cutting through the air as a toboggan, but I like it regardless. It
doesn't need to
happy.
Make sense to be awesome.
It doesn't. I like what Flandre's done here. He's decided to pick up just the flask, means that you pop all of them while you're taking a camp, and then you can grab a cloth armor.
Snake have decided to lane swap here. I'm not sure if they were doing it to predict what Edward Gaming would do, but they are the ones that have opted to utilize this lane swap, and they've forced themselves into the 1v2 situation. Maybe because, as we mentioned, the Gnar has a good lane against the Hecarim, but they decided to get out of that lane. The Hecarim can jungle. He does have Smite. That's a big advantage for them in that respect anyway. So they've got the Corki and the Morgana top.
Yeah, and it does mean, yeah, you're right. So the double jungle probably going to be working out in favor of Snake here, which is largely why they'd want to opt into this, because, of course, you know, Clearlove struggling to do a whole lot of AoE clear as the Pantheon. I haven't seen a Pantheon jungle for a heck of a long time, but it is going to be vertical jungling as this EDG duo going to be heading towards the blue buff. So it's going to be double buffs for both teams as is just going to be vertically moved. As EDG going for a very quick shove here in the bottom side of the map, really pushing up on this outer turret in the bot lane.
Yeah, they pushed in early. They're not going to be able to do a whole lot of damage to the turret, but they're at the very least denying the chance of a teleport coming in from the top laner of Snake. Flandre's not going to be able to get a lot of minions, and they don't have vision of where Koro and Clearlove are, so he's not going to risk teleporting there on the chance of maybe dying.
That's
a lot of times we've seen the teleport, the reaction has been to dive them.
Yeah, immediately. Yeah. And it's always been a bad idea. Never teleport at 3.5 minutes to a lane with two men in it. It's just a silly idea.
Speaking of, he is now in base and opting to walk there instead. So he might be able to save his own skin by timings. I don't know just yet. We will see very soon.
Yeah, Flandre, of course, holding onto the teleport, like you mentioned, but we'll see whether he actually decides to head towards that outer turret. Ooh, Snake looking for something. Oh, Flandre, there's the flash into the pulverize as well. Headbutt's going to be available. Flandre over the wall now as well, but no flash for the horse. And Flandre just caught out. Oh, is he going to be able to escape? No, he's not. Last auto attack there from Koro, and that locks that one down. So Koro already with a massively better start than prior.
And talk about patience. We called that from the moment he was recalling.
Yeah.
And they sat there. They put one ward down when there was no minions there. And they waited for a very long time. They do get the kill. The teleport is still available, mind you. So he could teleport somewhere. Not going to risk it going bottom again because there's no vision. Whilst they do the dragon.
Yeah, this dragon taking a long time to go down, though, as Koro tanking this one up as best he can. Down to about 200 health. But Meganar is going to help him, giving him about 100 back. And look, this dragon is going to fall down. No vision available from Snake.
Yeah, there's not going to be really a way for them to get in there and contest that, though. They didn't have the Hecarim, though the teleport was available. But that means that they would have to teleport for the Hecarim to be there, and they would also have to face check somewhere to put the ward down in the first place. So it's a big risk for them to go near that dragon. That is one kill, one dragon now to Edward Gaming. They're looking pretty good.
They most certainly are. And Boots was the pickup from Flandre as well as that flask, so picked up some extra jungle camps as well. But Martin, you can see, able to pick himself up a bit of a CS advantage by about 12 now as the lanes are going to equalize. EDG going to send Def towards the top side of the map. Pawn continuing to take a whole lot of harass here in the mid lane as the CS advantage going quite in favor of you.
Not a massive surprise that the CS advantage is in favor, but you can see every single time that Pawn goes for their last hit.
Oh, there's the all in here from Pawn as well. He's popped the W, doing a whole lot of auto attack damage. There's the ignite, and Yu's going to flash out of the way. Probably not going to be enough to net him the kill, but Pawn asserting his dominance here in the mid lane.
And this is Pawn in a nutshell. Wants to win lane, so picking the Fizz into the Cassiopeia matchup is a sign of him wanting to be aggressive. And once he hit that level 5 power spike, just went straight in onto the side of Snake here and did a lot of damage to Yu, forcing the flash, but it was for the ignite. Does get some CS though, and we'll even it up by a fair bit.
Yeah, you The most important part was the fact that he was just about to hit that level 6 as well. Pawn has managed to pick that level up now, but making sure that Pawn knew that, you know, he can go aggressive when the Petrifying Gaze is something he doesn't have to consider.
Yeah, if there's no level 6 available, it's not really there to outplay unless the poison hits to start with. And the damage that Pawn does do to the Cassiopeia very early in the game is quite high, in fact, because very low HP champion is Cass.
Yeah, and she's not going to be able to move out of the way as well, so you can get a whole lot of the auto attacks down from that Seastone Trident. But you can see Snake positioning around this bottom side of the map, and Koro has to be careful. Deft getting a whole lot of free time with this top lane out of turret. Clearlove miles and miles away from anything that his team's doing, and Snake probably going to be able to get a whole lot of damage down onto this outer turret, and at least going to deny a minion wave away from Koro.
Yeah, so they decided to swap back here on the side of Snake, and it seems to me as though they really do not want that 1v1 between the top laners, or they just really do not want the 2v2 between the AD carry and support. And I mean, based off Def being really far ahead in levels, I'm not surprised.
Yeah, teleport going to come through here. Nice shot with the fish. The Void Orca coming in towards the mid lane. It's going to be first turret falling in favor of Snake, though, as they take down the bottom outer. Nice purchase of the Sheen as well. Martin knew exactly what he wanted to do. He wanted to be doing as much damage to turrets as he could. That Sheen is going to give it that.
Yeah, it's a very good adaption, in fact, on the build that he would normally have, which tends to be the Phage first to give some effective combat stats.
Here comes the dive. You in a whole lot of trouble. Whoa. He wants to try and use the ultimate, but he's unable to. There it is. Eventually in the end, but it's going to be Pawn. Able to do a whole lot of damage. Clearlove, he nets himself a kill. Only level 4. A bit squishy is the Pantheon. Going for the Warrior Enchantment as well by the looks of things, but Beast coming in to try and at least protect this turret now. EDG asserting their dominance around this map. Outer turret going to fall in the top lane as Deft. He's just been left alone. They don't want to have anything to do with this Urgot.
And this is a very scary situation to be in on the back of Snake right now. And Urgot being left alone is fine and well, but he's also free farming levels, which is really big because Urgot scales so well and ramps up with damage when he gets those levels on the Acid Hunters. Especially even when once he gets levels in the ultimate, the range on the Reverser?
Yeah.
Really high. So putting him by himself is a really good decision here on the side of Edward Gaming. Alistar does not need to babysit an Urgot. In fact, he can 1v1 the top laner because top Urgot is a thing. And it's a very good position all around. Snake need to start doing something again. The lead's not massive, I know that, but they need to find a scenario where they at least come out with a small advantage.
Yeah, Beast does have the Black Shield, so Mako not going to find the knock-up onto the Gragas. As you does have that tier stacking up. No magic mantle there, probably wants to turn into... Oh my goodness, there's the ult in the mid lane. Pawn with so much damage. Koro flashing forward. The Hyper Proc's there, but Pawn locks it down with an auto attack, and the Fizz really getting rolling now. And that's only 2 Doran's Ring worth of damage.
Well, this is Fizz coming into its stride just from raw power of spells. Not even needing items. Doesn't need a Sheen. Doesn't need that much kill pressure. Cassiopeia is just a very squishy champion. And then you've got Koro there at the side to at least give you the reassurance that if I get ganked, I've got backup. So he just goes all in, hits the spells, knows that Cass has no flash, and that helps a lot. They pick up another kill here, and that is a 1-0-1 Fizz with a CS advantage of 12 over Cass.
Yeah, almost managed to pick up that Morellonomicon outright as well. Only about 800 gold necessary to finish off that item as well. And the cooldown reduction is a huge deal. 4 of Fizz now has 10% extra. What with that Forbidden Idol now sitting in his inventory. But look, Pawn does have his Ignite back up. Fish almost there as well. And you has to be careful. He can't go anywhere near this lane.
Yeah, look at the pressure. Even the Alistar, Mako just sitting near mid with the chance of maybe Yu's going to come out too far and I can engage again. But Ella's aware of it this time. They've got the wards on, at least on the bottom side of mid. In fact, all of their wards are useful for mid as Pantheon.
Oh, there's the Grand Skyfall. It's Clearlove tanking up this turret, but takes so much damage. Oh. Martin turns it around, and this Pantheon thought he was a little bit tankier than he otherwise was.
Maybe used to having the Cinderhawk. A small mistake right there for Clearlove at the same time.
Yeah, Pawn's just going to kill you again. And we sort of knew that that was something that could happen. So no surprises as his fish came up and he just kills the snake.
Yeah, not really a surprise at all at this stage. The lead is really high. Cassiopeia's gone for the tier first and Snake are going to get this dragon from the looks of it. But Edward Gaming are aware.
Yeah, a little bit of an overexcited play there coming through from Mako. From Clearlove, as Mako's actually going to go aggressive. Dark Binding going to land here onto the cow, but down to a relatively low health. There's the explosive cast as Flandre comes in. There's the switch. That's going to kill Mako, if anything. Yep. Uses the ultimate just to lock down that one. Death, though, with a whole heap of damage. There's the last Acid Hunter. Locks that one down. Pawn making his presence known as well, but that's going to even out the dragons, if anything. And it's a one-for-one trade.
Deft with no regard for his support there, throwing the Hecarim straight on top of him.
Yep, that cow was under the bus.
Making
definitely.
A trade, getting the dragon. It's pretty good for Snake all in all after that fight right there. They do need to reassess right now. I guess Clearlove made a small mistake earlier as well. Going for that warrior enchant, the Corki's starting to ramp up. Yeah. Ergot probably on equal footing in terms of ramping up at the moment though. So the next fight is going to be a big determiner of... It's going to dictate who's actually ahead in this game, even though the gold lead is in favor of Edward Gaming.
Yep.
At 12 minutes into this game, a gold lead that big, not a massive deal. So the next fight, you really want to look to see who comes out ahead, and they'll be the ones controlling from at least that point on.
Yeah, the giant enemy crab bot Deft here in the bottom lane is going to be able to take down this outer turret, trying to deny as much farm as possible from Flandre, who is on the horse. Of course, scaling is definitely a word that you're going to use for a Hecarim. Very even as far as his top lane farm is concerned. He's managed to find some from somewhere by the looks of things. Went straight for those home guard boots as well, as the Skirmisher Saber is there at the same time. So he's got at least the tools to try and be that Hecarim in these team fights, but not quite there yet as Beast misses everything.
I would wager that most of the farm is from the jungle for this Hecarim at the moment.
Yeah, that's true.
Hasn't had a whole lot of time laning, and when he does, he needs to leave straight away for a fight. Dragon is an example.
True.
So most of that money will come from the jungle. And Koro, in response, having very equal CS and having a pickaxe versus Pantheon.
Grand Skyfall here to the top lane as Snake trying to reposition themselves. It's a nice barrel, but Darkbinding not going to find its mark here. Koro, there's a one-man Gnar ultimate, but Beast using that explosive cast. Koro's going to get taken out very early on here as Deft trying to solo out Martin gets switched around. Actually doesn't quite find it as the Darkbinding going to interrupt that one. Ella going to get punished for his insolence. As Pawn locks down the kill with the Playful Trickster, Martin ignored, but the inner turret now under siege from the horse of Flandre. Just the general Flandre things here, as he just wants to be a nuisance at every point of the game. You're going to take down his blue buff. And I guess they were just happy to trade one for two.
Well, that's the strength of the Pantheon ult right there, though. You don't often take into account that he is in fact a Pantheon and suddenly appears in front of you and zoned them into the bush area. They do pick up the trade on Koro straight away, whose ult was not necessarily worth noting in this case. But the binding from Morgana, selflessly saving his AD carry, stopping the hyperkinetic position reversal.
Oh, Mako might get caught out just a little bit. He uses the Unbreakable Will to get out of the snare. Thought the Pawn was just going to kill you once more. But, of course, I guess didn't have the Chum the Waters, so might have saved you's life just a little bit. What I was saying, my goodness, before was the fact that Pawn was two levels ahead of you. And when you're a 4-0-1 Fizz on the map, I mean, you're feeling pretty good, and you most definitely not having the best experience in this game.
There's definitely a chance that you're feeling quite good here on the side of Edward Gaming, because you've got a 4-0-1 Fizz. The levels that he has, the advantage, is pretty much just because he's been able to solo kill. And that gives you a lot of experience getting kills by yourself. So doing very well for himself. But you have to give credit to Ella right now. Hitting the bindings and saving teammates very well timed. Doing the best Mako impression possible.
Yeah, he's doing the best that he can. I mean, we saw a dark binding miss. So a little bit unfortunate. But I mean, I guess he's got one.
But now he just has to hit everyone afterwards.
Yeah. Yep, all of them. Trinity Force completed by Martin, though. Going towards possibly either a Bloodthirster or Blade of the Ruined King, maybe even a Last Whisper, although I don't necessarily like that build quite as much. Doesn't have the Sork Boots yet, so we'll see whether he is going to go for those Sork Boots or whether it is going to be maybe more of an auto-attack-based build from this Corki. It has worked in the past. Of course, Spawn, a massive advocate of that one. Does like to see Berserker's Greaves picked up, just because in this tanky meta, you want to be able to do as many auto-attacks as you can. It's the best way to get it done.
Yeah, and you can change up your build a little bit based off having the Berserker Greaves, not needing the Sorcshoes.
Oh, another Headbutt Pulverize now onto you, but they are able to disc Disengage from this one. Maker going to get slowed down just a little bit, but Deft is going to get explosive cast back into the team. Martin looking to try and get something turned on here as Flash almost available again for Deft. Grant, Skyfall coming in. Yu gets taken down super low. Clearlove locks down that kill, but Koro, massive Gnar against the wall. EDG, low health bars, but still in control of this. And here comes Pawn. Beast completely out of mana. Flandre gets switched into the team. Generally something you want as a Hecarim, but in the meantime, the rest of Snake just getting torn apart. EDG rolling over them at this stage, and the snowball, it's begun for EDG.
Well, it looked like they caught Deft out of position. You'd say that the explosive cast put him in a bad spot, but suddenly the Grand Skyfall, Mako hitting the pulverized combo on three people inside it, doing the full damage of that Skyfall.
Yep.
Absolutely ridiculous. Follow that with Koro, hitting the Gnar into the ideal targets that were stuck in all of this beforehand. And then you have the makings of a great team fight there from Edward Gaming.
Yeah, and Yu was unable to do anything. He almost got soloed out by Mako in the middle of that Headbutt Pulverize combo. So, of course, like you mentioned before, it's Cassiopeia very squishy, but under-leveled at the same time. Now 0-4-0, almost has the Abyssal Scepter done, but really wants to try and get some more farm on this map. Yeah, Martin seems to be the saving grace, but let's see this one again.
So you could see Def getting caught out of position. I said it looks bad for them, but suddenly Mako gets the call, turn around, teleport, Grand Skyfall, Yu's caught in a bad position from the Pulverize, and suddenly everything just turns on its head. Snake, now in a really bad position, have to retreat. Pawn shows his face finally, destroys Beast, and from there that was a good team fight from EDG.
Yeah, Snake trying to answer with a dragon here, as Deft is going to get shot back in with that ultimate from Flandre. Mako caught out a little bit in position, is going to fall down. Clearlove now as well, not very tanky here on this Pantheon. The fish going to land on Ella though. Pawn trying to flash out of this one as well. Not quite as tricky as he otherwise would be, but a double kill as he comes down with the playful trickster. Beast as well does have to get out of the way of everything that he can. Noxian corrosive charge though was down. The Acid Hunter is going to lock that one through as Deft cleans up another kill. EDG just don't seem to be able to do anything wrong. Mako got caught out, and then they get three kills off the back of it.
It just feels like now they've got Koro and Pawn, they feel like the strongest EDG side that they could be at the moment. They're showing that right now. They're team fighting. The rotations, it's all starting earlier for them and stronger. Is Martin going to give it a crack?
Oh, close.
Just not in time.
Relatively close. Of course, Smite was used, so Clearlove probably was going to have the maximum damage amount on that one. But Brutalizer was completed by Deft, not actually going for the Black Cleaver build. Is Deft on this Urgot, so it's just not going to be the thing this time around. Of course, I would have thought that Black Cleaver would have been a better option here just because you're going to be up against so much magic damage, but not going to be the case. Probably knows that he's going to be dealing with more of Flandre than anyone else, so needs to be building a bit of that armor if he wants to deal with that, but I guess at this point in the game, 7,000 gold ahead at 19 minutes. EDG feeling like they can build basically whatever they want.
Yeah, given the fact that they are this far ahead, going for the Brutalizer, turning it into armor, and even getting the pickaxe after is a sign that he wants to get the effective item sooner to do damage, and the cooldown reduction is the big factor on why he's gone for the Brutalizer and the Glacial Shroud. Doesn't need to go for the Black Cleaver because he has the CDR from elsewhere now, and both of those items are very cost efficient, and they're very good for the stats they provide for the money, and mid-game oriented, as we see Pawn might be giving this a go.
Yeah, there's the playful trickster. The fish is down as well. Clearlove doesn't even do anything there as Pawn is going to let his W take the kill.
Yeah, just casually walk away. Cool guys don't look at explosions.
They certainly don't.
What I've heard. So
neither does Pawn. I guess he's a cool guy.
It makes him a cool guy there.
Yeah, I think he's proven it. Not his phenomenal mid lane play. It's going to be the fact that he doesn't look at explosions. Deft going to try his very best to lock down this Crimson Brambleback. That is going to be taken there as Koro. He's doing battle with Martin, but Martin seems to be underestimated time and time again by EDG. And Koro does have to back away. Bounces up the wall, he's going to be safe, but underestimate the Corki. He's got some damage.
Yeah, 1-0-3 Corki's got the Trinity Force finish. That's his big item. And
Flandre just going to delete Koro. Yep, you ain't going to be taking down that Grump. Might even transition into a steal of this blue buff as well. Flandre doing his very best to have an impact this game. 3-5-0. He's contributing to a large majority of the kills for his team, 60%, and also a large amount of their deaths.
He's contributing across the board.
He is.
And stealing buffs, he's also contributing to that. So he's doing a lot, It's not going so well for him at the moment. He does have the Corki who's big. The Morgana's doing a lot of work and the Gragas has been initiating a fair bit successfully. But you have a look at the mid lane matchup and this is the big talking point right now is that Pawn is very far ahead.
Super far ahead.
He's so far ahead of you that the Cassiopeia has an Abyssal Scepter as the first item. And let's have a look at the difference in gold.
Oh my god!
Just a bit.
Yeah, that's 2.5k. At 21 minutes into the game. So Fizz, relatively far ahead. 200 gold ahead is Flandre though, because of course he's been taking a whole heap of these monster camps, so that is definitely a shining light. But somehow Clearlove is also 2,000 gold ahead of his direct opponent. Oh, you unable to land the petrifying gaze. Wrong direction there just a little bit. It was going to be very, very cute. But not quite able to.
It is difficult to execute the flash and the petrifying gaze at the same time. Sometimes it goes a little bit awry and ends up backwards. So unfortunate there. I think he was most likely dead anyway.
Yeah, I think, don't you have to petrifying gaze first and then flash to cancel it or something like that? Isn't that sort of how it works?
It kind of just happens how it happens sometimes.
You just got to believe.
Yeah, you just need to believe and it'll work in your favor. I guess he just didn't believe enough.
Yeah, no, you've got to make sure you believe you. But Lucidity Boots and the Merlinomicon and the Zhonya's Hourglass completed from Pawn. He's got everything he needs to be as annoying as possible. So much untargetability, so much cooldown reduction, so he's going to be just playfully trickstering around everywhere. This Fizz is going to be a massive problem. Legendary now on the Rift.
And you compare that to the Cassiopeia's items, it's just the Abyssal Scepter, the Tear, and the Blasting one with Boots 1. The difference between them is massive. The next team fight is going to be near impossible for Snake to come out ahead unless they kill Pawn first. But then you've also got to deal with the fact that there is a surprisingly big Pantheon with an Urgot that is also 305, has the Last Whisper finished now, has a lot of CDR from the two mid-game items that have been bought and completely foregone finishing those for extra damage.
Flandre, seeing whether he can get something done here, uses the Onslaught of Shadows just to save himself. The Ignite was down from Pawn, so he's going to get a Summoner spell out of it in trade for result. So not too bad. But the rest of EDG are going to turn up. Koro going to do his very best to try and take down this inner turret in the top lane as well. Flandre has popped the Devastating Charge, trying to get amongst something, but they know that his ultimate is down. What the heck, Deft?
He has the Muramana finished at 22 minutes, I believe it was completed.
Okay.
He has the Last Whisper, has the Brutalizer, all of the makings for a lot of hurt, and that is exactly what he's dishing out to you right now.
Yeah. Well, not me. Oh, wait, you. Got it. It's always a confusing name, as Deft is just going to smack down his turret in the bottom lane. Oh, there's the ultimate from Clearlove. They're looking to try and get something done, but they don't find their way in just yet. Devastating Charge onto Koro, but Meganar is rightly available. Martin making his way down as well. Mako caught out just a little bit, but Deft swaps himself in as well. You're just going to get taken down. Deft tanking this turret forever. He's going to fall down. Pawn does get exhausted. We'll see whether he can get anything done after that's worn off. As Snake think that this is going to be the team fight that they can come out on top of. That is going to be Pawn falling down. Mako as well. Helicopter Flandre crashing through this team fight. Almost a quadra kill, but Martin getting the work done. Clearlove flashes over the wall. He's going to be the last remaining member of EDG alive. They can't underestimate Snake. They can do crazy things in team fights.
And they did exactly what was required of them. They destroyed the important targets first. The Gragas Explosive Cask was the MVP of that entire fight right there. Knocked them all away. Everyone that was important that was dealing damage was either under the turret or they were so far away they were not relevant for the next 5 seconds.
We have to put down that Deft also switched himself under the turret.
Yeah, he did.
So that wasn't exactly great.
No, but no. I mean, the Gragas ult to follow it was definitely what secured him staying under the turret.
Very true.
And then it was capitalized on by Martin and Flandre, who are doing exceptional amounts of damage right now. You've got the power spike in that Trinity Force Blade of the Ruined King.
Yeah.
You used the active in that fight, so it was definitely available. And you've got the Frozen Heart on two members here, the Gragas and the Hecarim. They both had a lot of, again, if you build tanky, it's an effective earlier teamfight stat. They used it perfectly.
They did very, very well. QSS now completed by Martin. He doesn't want to get swapped into EDG. That is something he doesn't want to deal with. So having that item is very much going to help him out. Almost the Spirit Visage completed. But let's have a look at this one again. Deft underneath the turret. Tanks it forever.
Pretty much casually suicides himself into the turret. And that was completely accredited to Beast, making sure he stayed under there. You can see Martin and Flandre right now. The Black Shield coming down, the amount of damage that they're able to freely do onto the side of EDG here. The Fish not available, Pantheon's ult not available, the Mega Gnar not available again. Everything just down. Snake capitalized on it so well. But speaking of...
Yeah, Beast is going to get swapped into the team of EDG. Does explosive cast some people, but he just gets bounced around. EDG going to take this as their invitation to do another Baron. Of course, the first for this game, but it's the EDG way. They want to try and get a pick, try and get a Baron. 26 minutes into the game, they are going to be able to take this one down. You have to think, because no jungler is there. They do have another smite. As Mako, he's going to use the Unbreakable Will to get out of that stun. The Baron does fall. Double knock-up now into Flandre and Ella. They're getting taken down solo. Pawn locks down the kill on the support as Flandre tries to escape here as well. The Fish lands. Oh, you flashes out of it, killing Flandre. Petrifying Gaze onto Clear Love. Decent Phosphorus one for Martin. And he's going to use that Valkyrie to get himself to safety. EDG, though, pick up the Baron, pick up two kills. And it now might be their time to break the base. They don't have any Siege, though. One thing we haven't really noticed is the fact that they got a heck of a lot of melee and an Urgot.
And that's also probably a big factor on why that last fight went really bad for EDG. But now they've found the pick onto Gragas straight away. Instantly go for the Baron. No hesitation from this side here. They secure that Baron, I believe. Yeah, they
did. Yeah, they most certainly did.
So I was looking at Snake Martin and I was thinking that he was on their side because where he's standing is very aggressive.
Yeah. He's being a ward.
He's... certainly being a ward right now, but again, they got the Baron, they found the picks that was required of them, and EDG suddenly turning it on and deciding that they want to come out ahead in this game at the moment.
Well,
just
yeah.
Out of nowhere, just let's just get a Baron and win.
Well, they were certainly doing some work in the earlier stages. It looked like Pawn was going to run away with it, but I mean, that last teamfight did show that Snake still had some fight in them. Pawn chucks the ward down, just dancing around a little bit here, as Martin did have the Valkyrie available. Pawn says, I can ward too. Very cute. Beast wants to take down this wolf camp. And Pawn just stalking this jungle. Snake with a fair few wards defensively around their own jungle. Going to be very, very useful. They need to hold on to some sort of vision control. But 20-9 as far as the kill score is concerned. 8.5 thousand gold in favor of EDG. It's 5 turrets to 2 though. That's completely amazing. Because EDG, like we mentioned before, Urgot has the lowest range for any sort of pseudo AD carry, and everyone else is melee. So I don't know how they're getting under these turrets to get anything done.
Well, I mean, it's pretty easy to get under a turret when someone's dead.
That's true.
And it does help a lot, and a lot of people have been dying. You can see 20-9 in kills in favor of EDG. They've got that Baron now, so their siege does ramp up by a fair bit, and they're starting to get control of the one area of the map where it looked really good for Snake, so we'll see if Flandre and the rest of his side can do something now to Deft.
Yeah, Flandre trying to battle Deft here as well as the teleport is coming in. There's a Grand Skyfall as Deft switches himself in, trying to save himself. Look at the use of the Locket of the Iron Solari as well as Deft is still alive. There's the explosive cask as Beast trying to save his own life. Flandre gets it turned around. Deft, what? How do you survive in these fights? Pawn just dancing around here as well as EDG looking to go aggressive once more. Baron buff still ticking down. And the fact that EDG could just turn on the emergency response unit and just send in the top laner and, of course, the jungle so quickly. Deft just survives and Snake, they're going to have to run the heck away. They've lost Flandre. Beast did have to go back to base and that's another turret down.
That's a really good way to describe it, the emergency response unit. Suddenly out of nowhere you get the Grand Skyfall, the teleports, no hesitation at the same time coming out to protect Deft. He used his ult, he swapped himself closer to the Grand Skyfall.
Yeah.
And it made him infinitely tankier than what he was just prior to using it as Pawn.
Yeah, there's the Chum the Waters as well. Pawn very, very slippery. And Beast is old.
No, he's dead.
Yeah. Koro did end up flashing over the wall just to make sure that he secured it, but Pawn did lock it down with the W, and everything is going to be A-okay. Flandre going to be taking down these Krugs in the bottom lane, and Beast just can't catch a break. Oh, Koro. Goomba stomps the Krug. And Flandre can't find anything either.
No one getting a break at the moment. It's quite difficult for anyone on the side of Snake to really get what they want. Dragon up in 25 seconds as well should be the next thing that EDG look to take. And they're very, very far ahead in terms of control of the map.
11,000
gold,
too.
Kills. Turrets. What they need to do now is start to close out this game, bleed out the vision control that's coming out from Snake. They're going to have a last-ditch attempt. Maybe it'll be for the Dragon. But if you're on the side of EDG, you just want to fight them away from a turret as soon as you can, because you said it, their siege is not all that great. Their range is not all that high. They've got the Pantheon, and they're actually only two ranged champions is the Mini Gnar and an Urgot.
Yeah, I guess, yeah, no, that's true. So Mini Gnar and Urgot. So I said that there were three melee, but I was only counting Megan. And I'm sorry, Corey, you do have range. It's not very high. It's most certainly there. Let's touch on the fact that Pawn is 12-1-3 as well. So he's having a pretty redonkulous game. Does have a needlessly large rod now on top of everything else. Lich Bane was completed. So Rabadon's Death Cap possibly going to be the next item. Might be Illudin's Echo. He might go for both as this game continues.
I wouldn't actually mind if it was Illudin's Echo. It gives extra move speed. And what more could you want as a Fizz besides extra move speed?
Yeah, it does just seem to be, you know, the optimal burst damage item.
Yeah, it's true.
Building burst, build 120 AP.
We have to eliminate Ella, by the way. That's two binds I've seen this.
Yep, sorry. Not quite Mako tier just yet. Saw a few in the previous team fighters. Oh, that one landed. They're going to notice the fact that EDG were scouting that one out. No vision available in there for Snake. And they can't get in their own jungle now as well, as EDG have just got them out of everything.
They are holding quite well at the moment, though. They haven't found a way to break the base at all yet. And the siege not being there from the side of Edward Gaming, they're going to need to find an opening pretty soon. Otherwise, they'll start to be giving a lot of free experience and farm to the side of Snake. If you just consistently push all three waves in and you don't actually take anything from it, you're pretty much just giving them free farm on a silver platter. So you need to find something soon. I guess with Baron up in 45 seconds, it'd be the perfect thing to do to at least help the siege. Or you could bait it, bring Snake there so that you don't have to fight under a turret where your siege is quite average.
No, I think it'll just be EDG. They'll just take the Baron and win the game. I just have a feeling that that might be what they decide to do.
Well, it does seem like the logical train of thought here.
And they were just waiting for the Baron. I think they understand that that's what they need in order to get any semblance of siege. So don't bother. Wait until that Baron's up. Use that to win. 15 seconds now until that one's up. EDG now positioning themselves around, making sure that Snake can't get towards this Baron. Loads of vision available. Noxian Corrosive Charge from Deft, I don't think, found the targets. As Koro is positioning himself, he's got a minion wave there so he can build up some Rage Bar if he wants to. It's now calming down just a little bit as EDG. They've got the Scuttle Crab and they've got exclusive vision around this Baron area. They're looking to start something. There's the Black Shield. Grand Skyfall coming in as well. There's the Flash from Yui. Gets immediately exhausted. Saracen Brace is down, but look at the knockups. Mako making it work, and Clearlove is going to get out of there. The Gnar into the wall. Flandre is going to get stunned up. Everyone from Snake is dying. Beast and Flandre, the only ones alive. Heroic effort from Flandre at this stage, but he's not going to find anyone. Clearlove just taunting him. Bounces on top. EDG, they were thinking about going for Baron because that's generally what they want to do, but instead, I think they might just win the game.
And finding themselves some kills will really make sieging a lot easier for them, given that they weren't really able to before. So the Baron bait, very smart idea, plays perfectly into the hands of EDG. They find all the kills, they just turn it on suddenly with the Pantheon ult, the Gnar coming in with Mega Gnar, you've got Pawn who uses the ultimate. Everything just happens at once and catches the side of Snake in a small choke point when they've got a lot of AoE. So very well done. They find themselves with two inhibitors down now. They can pretty much just go for the Baron again or decide to go bottom and close out this game very, very convincingly from here on out, unless a big mistake does come out.
Yeah, it'll have to be a massive mistake, as Snake might go for a desperation Baron maneuver here as well, as a teleport from Flandre. He wants to try and stop someone from backing here so that they can claim ownership of this Baron area. Koro, probably not the target that he's able to lock down, as he uses the ultimate on a Mako as well. Unbreakable Will was there. Flandre maybe a little bit overexcited. The rest of Snake have started off the Baron though. It's down to half health. EDG were wanting to go back. 4,000 health now. They've got double smite. Beast and Flandre able to get that one done. Chum the waters though onto Flandre, and you just gets destroyed by that. EDG turning this one around. The swap to get Flandre out of everything. Deft is going to turn it around, pick up the kill. And EDG once again, this time a clean ace.
That was the desperation Baron attempt. We're seeing the surrender vote, in fact, coming out here from the side of Snake, as the camera doesn't want to show it blow up.
That was an interesting maneuver. I like that one a lot, but it is going to be the surrender coming through from Snake. Not a whole lot they could do, of course. Pawn just snowballing out of control. A fantastic game from that guy. Two Varuses and a Fizz now, and look, he's just brilliant.
He is absolutely unstoppable right now. He's completely out of control. You said it. He's massive. Found kills in lane, solo 1v1.
Yeah.
You not having an impact at all compared to the first game where he was doing a lot of work.
Yeah, and you, I mean, we saw his Cassiopeia performance previously. He can play that champion to a very high level, but just unable to. Pawn just picking his timings for all-ins at fantastic moments. And despite the fact that his first attempt didn't manage to pick up the kill, he got the level advantage that he needed. He just made sure that he picked it at exactly the right time. And congratulations to EDG, 2-0 over Snake. So now the record is evened out. Three games apiece over the entirety of this year.
Yeah, the only team that's managed to come out positively against EDG now even. So not a single team at the moment actually being positive against the side of Edward Gaming. Looking
I guess you could say, you know, positive. It's still semi-positive because...
Well, it's like, not negative. Even.
That's true. It's not negative, but I guess you're right. It's not positive.
But now no team coming up. They're looking really strong right now, EDG, coming into this next split. The summer split, starting with a bang.
Yeah, it's a very, very frightening one. But ladies and gentlemen, we've still got two more series to come. M3 going to be taking on World Elite after this short break.